celebrate when you want it, when you commemorate the dead and the living. In this hill were first brave men who died in an earlier war, a savage war here in our own country. It was a cruel moment in our nation's history. But these memories, sad and sad, remind us with pride of our obligation and our opportunity. We cannot save ourselves by abandoning those who are associated with us or rejecting our responsibility. And to the dead here in this cemetery, we say they are the race. They are the race immortal whose beams make broad the common light of day. Though time may dim, though death has barred their portal, these we salute, which may not pass away.
Though I never did reach the state of professional and physical perfection
or I could hope that anyone would ever mistake me for an Annapolis graduate. I know that you were constantly warned during your days here not to mix in your naval career in politics. I should point out, however, on the other side, that my rather rapid rise from a reserve lieutenant among certain standings with Commander-in-Chief has been because I did not follow that very good advice. Many Americans tend to think of developing underdeveloped countries in terms only of faraway nations. In 1863, this nation had fewer railroad tracks laid than India has today, and its children had a shorter life expectancy than a child born this year in Thailand or Zanzibar. What can be summed up in that past 100 years? I think the history of it can be summed up in 2 words. And that is economic growth. And yet we've heard in recent times that economic growth is too abstract a concept, that it's too academic for politicians and voters, that it's too theoretical a basis for proposals to the Congress. I do not see anything abstract or academic about economic growth. It means finding 1,200,000 additional jobs every year for the men and women pouring into our labor market, half of them below the age of 25. There's nothing theoretical about that. every president of the United States has placed special reliance upon his faith in God. Every president has taken comfort and courage and told, as we are told today, that the Lord will be with thee, he will not fail thee nor forsake thee, fear not, neither thou be dismayed. It is an ironic fact that in this nuclear age, when the horizon of human knowledge and human experience has passed far beyond any that any age has ever known, that we turn back in this time to the oldest source of wisdom and strength, to the words of the prophets and the saints, who tell us that faith is more powerful than doubt, that hope is more potent than despair, and that only through the love that is sometimes called charity can we conquer those forces within ourselves and throughout all the world that threaten the very existence of mankind. The guiding principle and prayer of this nation has been, is now, and shall ever be, in God we trust. Sometimes think we are too much impressed by the clamor of daily events. Yet it is the profound tendencies of history and not the passing excitement that will shape our future. The short view gives us the impression of a nation being shoved and harried everywhere on the defense. But this impression is surely an optical illusion. From the perspective of Moscow, the world today may seem even more troublesome, more intractable, and more frustrating than it does to us. Wisdom requires the long view. We must think and act, not only for the moment, but for our time.